Lord. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Yes, he is Lord.
He is Lord.
He is Lord. And he has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. I'm gonna bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. I will bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. I'm gonna bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. For he is Lord. He is Lord. And he has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord.
Oh, He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Yeah, He is Lord.
And He has risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, everybody. Good to see everybody here in the house of the Lord. February 28th, 2021. Did you think you'd make it this far?
I think it was
The song says we come this far by faith. Amen. Guess what? We went through an election and we survived. Guess what? We have a new president and we've survived. Guess what? It's a new day and we're here. Amen. Amen. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad I'm here. And today is a special day. Today is what we call Rescue Sunday. And we hope you came prepared to give an extra offering. But if you did not, you can always bring it tonight. Or you can bring it and give it some other time, but sooner the better. As we want to rescue, our goal is to at least rescue one young lady from sex trafficking. And that one young lady is worth it. And $1,500, that's not a whole lot of money, really, when you think about it and consider that you're going, that agents from Destiny Rescue are going to go in because of the sponsorship and the support and the prayer of the people of God. They're going to go into these places where these girls feel like they're trapped and can't get out. And that's all they know, and that's all they're going to have to live the rest of their lives. And yet the power of God and the power of prayer and a few little bucks here and there, enough money to sponsor these efforts, pay great dividends. And you're going to hear a whole lot about that later. But I'm glad Tom and Sarah, my son-in-law and daughter, are here, and they're here to represent Destiny Rescue. And it's going to be a beautiful day. And I believe it'd be awesome if we could rescue too. It wouldn't hurt my feelings one bit. But I appreciate everybody that's going to help and support and know that it's going to be good. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and let's open up. Always we open up. This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. Oh, this is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made. That the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Yes, what a mighty God we serve. The angels bow before Him. Heaven and earth adore Him. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. The angels bow before Him. Heaven and earth adore Him. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. For this is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made. That the Lord hath made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, and this is the day that the Lord hath made. Turn around to your neighbor and wave at him. Then wave at the camera and let everybody that's watching from home, let them know you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord. Glad you joined us by way of the internet. Oh, this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother Jason, you can be seated.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jason. Yeah, right on. Go, Jason. He's awesome. Nice to see you guys this morning. And so, I guess looks like it's Destiny Rescue Sunday. So I think somebody already said something about that, so I'm going to move on past that. Yesterday we was at the flea market, and we were passing out, Space Coast City Fest tickets and stuff. And I want to say probably more than 1,000 tickets was passed out, okay? I mean, yeah, right. That's awesome. Yeah, praise the Lord. There was let's see here. My cousin, Andy and Tina, they came, and Celeste and Bill and Janice Gerler came, and they were all passing out so many tickets. I went to walk around and pass out tickets. I couldn't get anybody to take none from me because they were like, no, we already got tickets. Somebody already gave us some. So that's awesome. That was a great time. And even when we're getting ready to take the booth down and leave, and a guy came over and he said, well, I'm renting that booth tomorrow. If you just leave that stuff there, I'll pass out tickets tomorrow too. So that's right. Praise the Lord. That's great. It's really awesome. So that was, I think, very effective. So that's for Space Coast City Fest, which is next weekend, okay? So next Saturday and Sunday, Space Coast City Fest. There won't be a service here next Sunday evening, but there will be somebody opening the church for prayer. If we get a volunteer, anybody want to volunteer right now? Huh? Who's got a church key and wants to come here Sunday? Oh, look, Paul. Paul can do it. Okay, Paul's going to be here next Sunday evening. If you want to come in and pray for, right, praise the Lord. Good job, Paul. Right on. And that way, if you guys can't make it up to Space Coast City Fest, you want to come here and pray for Space Coast City Fest, that'd be awesome. That'd be just great, too. So the only announcements I got here is a business meeting March 7th. Sunday morning, right directly following church, we're going to have a business meeting. So if you want to hear about what kind of things are coming up in the new year, Sherry, what's going on? No, it's free admission. Anybody that wants to go to Space Coast City Fest can go free. So Space Coast City Fest will have dirt bike tricks and BMX tricks and 6 different bands and hopping up and down or whatever Celeste is trying to say. Oh, bounce house is for the kids, not jumping up and down in your seat. My bad. Okay. So it's going to be a great time. Everybody's going to have a lot of fun up there. And so, you know, come on out.
I just want to say something, Jason, in terms of the meeting. The business meeting is not a full-blown meeting. It will only be 2 items that we have to get approval from the church. It will not take your lunchtime. It will, unless I preach longer than normal. But otherwise, it will only be for 2 items that we need to take care of, and that's it. So we'll just ask folks to stay over for about 5 or 10 minutes, and we got to get approval for, and then once that's done, you can go eat. So
it won't take your lunch time, but maybe Cracker Barrel reservations for like 2 o'clock instead of 1 o'clock next week. So, okay, men's breakfast the first Saturday is next Saturday. So we're going to have a men's breakfast next Saturday. Any men, come on out and have some fun with us. And you know what else? If you're looking for something during the week, like a Bible study to get involved in, right here on Tuesday at 10 a.m., there's a ladies' Bible study. Then Tuesday at 5:30 p.m., there's another Bible study for anybody who wants to watch online. Wednesday from noon to 1, there is a Bible study right here in the sanctuary. Anybody's welcome to come to that. And it's also live online. And Friday, starting at 1, there's a prayer meeting. So there's all kinds of stuff going on this week. If you want to get involved with anything at all, there's all kinds of stuff going on. So I think that's all I got to say, and I'm going to turn it back over to the pastor.
Thank you, Brother Jason. I was excited about how many people were seen that I talked to, and I know others that talked to there at the flea market yesterday. People were really grateful that we had told them about it. You can see signs, but that don't tell much. It's just a name recognition. But when you give a personal information, hey, it's free, hey, it's for the whole family, hey, it's going to do this and that, and it really kind of people, it's free. Everybody likes free. And so it's going to be a great time. And we still have time. Do we have tickets on hand? We give them all away? Yeah. But you, by word of mouth, I've been telling people, even if I didn't have a ticket, I go, you know, to Dollar General or wherever I go, and I just tell people about it. The more people that can go, especially unsaved, unchurched people that don't know the Lord, that need Jesus, this is going to be a perfect opportunity for them to go enjoy a festival and at the same time hear the gospel presentation. It's going to be a great time. We need you to be praying. If you can't make it to the church to pray, pray all evening on Sunday evening if you can't be there. That would be much, much appreciated. Amen. Thank you, Brother Jason, and appreciate that. The men's ministry sponsored that table yesterday, so thank you, men. Give the men a hand for that. We appreciate the brothers doing that. We're going to go to God in prayer, and we've got a lot to pray about. Give me one. Anybody have a praise report? God's answered something specific for you. Mac? All right. Praise the Lord. I know Mac works hard in his job, and he's been faithful to his job, and also see him dropping money in the offering, saying, God's the one that does everything, takes care of my needs, and that's the way it works. God always blesses when you honor the Lord. Brother Chuck? Oh, did you hear that? Woo! So you're getting there. You're almost ready to sing again. Almost ready to sing again. I've come too far to look back, Brother Chuck. Amen. All right. We got a lot to pray about. We have Brother Willie and Sister Pauline. We're still praying for them. Pastor Joe Hill said that he did better this time when he had his chemo treatment, and he is stronger than before. We're really praying for him. My friend and brother Harry Frazier is in OSU Hospital, and he's on a ventilator, and his platelet count is low, and there's a lot of things going on right now in his health, but we know God can do it, and we pray for Harry. We're also praying. Brother Chuck lost his brother this week. The other day, his brother passed away, and Brother Chuck, Sister Sharon, will be traveling here in a little bit to go up to the services. Please keep the Baker family in prayer. They all need our prayers. We're just also praying for Wesley. He had his procedure the other day, and the doctor said when they went in there, it was a little worse than they thought. They had to scrape his pelvic bone and do some extra work there. So please pray for little Wesley. And of course, Space Coast City Fest, the outreach we've got in Wendover Palms and also the Meadows and other places where we've been reaching out, we're praying that God will move and bring in souls. We pray for Billy. That's Carol Staten's brother. That's got blockages in his leg. And The Equal Rights Act. Has anybody followed that on the news? I just want to tell you that that is a serious, serious decision that our Congress is right now grappling with, trying to decide. And give you just a small example. In this bill would allow for a three-year-old to decide whether they want to be a boy or a girl. And then churches would have to allow men to go into women's bathrooms. We're talking about a very serious bill, and it's already been passed in the House, and it's going into the Senate. We need to pray that God will stop this, because our president has said he would sign it if it gets passed. So please pray about this matter, because it will affect the church as we know it today. So it's a big deal. Brother Steve? Okay, so it won't stop me from preaching. Amen. And there's a lot of folks in prison or jail that needs the Lord. So I might have a jail ministry before it's over. So we're praying for Andrea. Did she get home, Susan? Beautiful. Okay, we're continuing to pray for her, okay? And Destiny Rescue, we're praying definitely, always, for Destiny Rescue, and we're praying for lost folks. Kathy Nimitz asked for prayer. She's in the hospital, just had neck surgery, and Jackie's nephew now having some kidney issues. We're praying for that situation. And so Janelle, somebody had requested the other day for Janelle. She's expecting a baby and has gallstones. And it's a real concern for the baby if they have to do anything. So pray for Janelle. Anybody else with a request before we go to God in prayer? Okay. Okay. Suzette. Okay. Suzette lost both parents within 2 weeks. So we pray for that family. All right. Anybody else? Tony?
My brother, as of yesterday, they said they was going to let him stay for another 3 days. And after that, tomorrow, they're going to pull him off the ventilator and let him go.
Okay.
Pray for the family. They are broken up in pieces.
Okay. Absolutely. And we're praying for that family. And we're just believing that God allowed your brother some time. And he did. Remember? The doctors kind of had give up on him already. He come off of the ventilator and was able to FaceTime his family and had his clear mind. So we trust that God gave him that chance to pray and accept Christ into his life. But we'll pray for your brother and family. Anybody else? Okay. Martha? Okay. Pray for healing for Tina, her knees. All right. All right. Martha having surgery the 12th. Paul? Beautiful. Beautiful. The power of prayer. The power of prayer. Can we stand together and let's sing together? Key of C. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Will something happen? And now I know. He touched me and he made me whole. He touched me. He touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know He touched me, and He made me whole. Let's pray together. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We bless your name. Lord, we magnify your name. We know that, God, you have done great things. Lord, that you are the great and mighty God, and that nothing is impossible with you. And Lord, today, as we just call upon your name, we're just believing that the name of the Lord will be praised. That, God, as we had praise reports today because of prayers answered, we'll have more praise reports next week because you answered more prayers and you've done more things for the glory of God. And Lord, and we just believe in God that you're going to show your mighty power, God, in these requests, that you're going to heal sick bodies, that you're going to, Lord, save souls. You're going to bless Destiny Rescue to continue, Lord, to do its great work throughout the world. And know that, God, you're going to do what only you can do. And we just pray, Lord, this very morning that you would have your way. Be with Tony's brother. Touch him in a special way, we pray in Jesus' name. Bless Chuck Baker and his family. Lord, his brother's wife and kids. And, Lord, all those, God, that are affected by the loss. We pray that you would have your way, God, in that family. Lord, we ask that you would bless, minister, God, unto those that, Lord, are sick. Wesley, still, Lord, recovering from this surgery. And we just pray for your blessing on him in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for touching Crystal. Thank you for moving. Thank you for healing. Thank you for doing your great work. We love you, Lord. God, our country is in your hands. And we just believe that, Lord, we are even getting more and more ripe for revival. We're getting closer to a time where people are beginning to turn unto the Lord and beginning to cry out to Jesus for guidance and for salvation and for help in their lives. Believe in God for souls. We pray that this outreach next week, God, and the ministry, Lord, of City Fest will, Lord, have great ripple effect throughout this county and this state. Lord, we just pray that a mighty work of God will be done, God, throughout this whole region for the glory of God. And we just pray, Lord, that your name be exalted. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Touch Willie and Pauline, Lord. Touch Brother Oswald. Lord, minister, God, we pray to those that are still battling with sicknesses. Brother Harry Frazier needs a miracle. Lord, do it again, God. Do it again, we pray. And we love you, Lord. We thank you. We glorify you. We praise you, Lord. We honor you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God, there's a lot of seeds being sown. Now, Lord, we claim for harvest, God. We're expecting, God, harvest. And much, much work, God, will be done. And for your name's sake, we love you, Lord. We glorify you. Will something wonderful happen? And now I know he touched me and he made me whole. If you have a physical need in your body, can you just lift your hand up right where you're at? And say, I really need a touch. Put it way up there. I want you to look around you, and if you see hands raised, would you just raise your hand toward them right now and just agree together that the healing power of God will be manifest. Lord, we pray for your divine power, God, to touch and to heal. Lord, to make whole. Lord, let your name be exalted and glorified in each and every life and every situation. Lord, those that are watching by way of internet, just let your presence be mighty there in that room where they're at. We pray that the glory of the Lord will rest upon them and the power of God will move and will touch them and make them whole, heal their sickness, take away the pain, do the Lord's work, God, in their bodies. for by your stripes we are healed. Lord, you are the one that gives us, Lord, miracles and healings. We just claim your mighty power to make well and to make whole. And we thank you for it and we love you for it. He touched me. Let's praise him. I believe the Lord is working already in this house today. And I believe God's hand is upon us. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Oh, something wonderful happened. And now I know he touched me and he made me whole. Remain standing. We're getting ready to sing. And I'm going to ask the ushers, don't take the offering plate. Leave the plate here. And during the service, if there might be somebody that just forgot today was Destiny Rescue and you want to dig down deeper, all cash offering today goes to Destiny Rescue. And then if you have a check, you make a check out, you put on the memo Destiny Rescue, and that way our treasurer will know exactly where that goes. And so if you haven't already prepared, or you got that $50 or $100 back that you want to go to the steakhouse, well, don't eat the steak. Rescue somebody. Dig down a little deeper. And during our worship, anytime you want to bring extra offering, this offering plate is right here, and we appreciate that. Amen. Let's worship the Lord. Amen. Let's praise him. This is one of my favorite hymns, Higher Ground. And I want to get to higher ground in my faith, don't you? And this, look at the words, the powerful words of this great song, worshiping the Lord and praising God. Amen. Well, I'm pressing on, come on, Bobby, the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Tina, too, still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. I want to go up. Lord, lift me up. Yes, and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world. Though Satan's darts at me are hurled, for faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Sing it out. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost high and catch the gleam of glory bright. But still I pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Sing it. Lord, lift me up. Oh, yes, Lord. And let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet
on higher ground. Lord, lift me up, yes, Lord, and let me stand by faith on heaven's table and a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Praise the Lord. Yes, Lord. I want to go higher. I want to go higher. We bring sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord. We not yet.
Sacrifice of praise.
Okay.
Unto the house of the Lord.
Sing it unto the Lord.
And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices.
Oh, sing it unto the Lord.
Oh, we bring sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord.
All right.
Oh, we bring sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord.
Giving him praise.
And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices.
Put your hands together while we play. One more time.
Oh, we bring sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord.
Yes,
we bring sacrifice of
praise. He's worthy of our praise.
Unto the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of praise.
My Jesus, my Savior,
Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter,
you're the
tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you.
Give it praise.
Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I love, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Thank you, Lord. We love you. love you, Jesus.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you.
Thank you, Jesus.
All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter,
you're the
tower of refuge and strength.
Yes, Lord.
Every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you.
Sing it out, church.
Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing.
Yes,
power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name.
Oh,
I sing for joy at the work of your hands, and forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have.
No, nothing compares to the promise I have.
And nothing compares to the promise I have.
Again, nothing compares to the promise.
One more time.
No, nothing compares to the promise I have. In you.
Shout to the Lord. Worship the Lord.
Oh, yes.
Oh,
power and majesty, praise to the King.
Mountains bow down
and the seas will roar at the sound of your name.
He's worthy, yes.
I sing for joy at the work of your hand,
and forever
I love you, forever I'll stand.
Yes,
oh, nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Oh,
nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
No,
nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Praise his holy name. Play it, Karen. Shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Yeah, I sing for joy at the work of your hands.
Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
No, nothing compares to the promise I have.
Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Somebody praise him one more time. One more time. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You can be seated. The kids, I guess, will go back. But just want to say how good it is. Yesterday when I left the flea market, I was going to go a certain direction to talk to a family, and the Holy Spirit just directed me to another location altogether. And I found myself talking to a Polish man and his wife who run a little shop over by Crystal Palace. And they got a neat little Polish shop. It's a European shop, basically. And they sell all kinds of European stuff. And I'm always interested in that anyway. And my goodness, how God just arranged and led me there to talk to that couple. And I was able to explain to him a difference between religion and relationship. And he was like, customers started coming in. He had to get up. He said, can you stay around? It's like I went in and I waited forever, it seemed like. But I got his cell number and he's got mine. And I said, call me anytime. He said, 2 a.m? I said, only if you need me. But I made a friend, and he was taken. I could tell the Holy Spirit was just driving home. He worked in New York City last year as an electrician in the biggest hospital in New York City. And COVID hit, and they moved down here and started that little shop. They need Jesus, and I'm praying for his salvation. I believe the Holy Spirit's going to do a great work in his life. Amen. Going to ask Brother Andy if you would come and sing, and then Pat, come get ready. And then we're going to go right into our ministry, Brother Tom and Destiny Rescue.
Would surely be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain too high and the valley too wide. Down oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Well, I thought I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees where I learned to stand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Sing verse 2 again, Andy.
Well, I thought a lot on my own. I thought
could make it all alone. I thought I could, as a mighty big man, Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain too high and the valleys too wide, down on my knees where I learned to stand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I hear people say something. Come on, Pat, you can get ready. I hear them say, oh, Christianity is for weaklings. Do you know the song, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know? For the Bible Tells Me So. They are, little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Can I tell you something? Humans are weak. The Bible calls followers of Jesus sheep, and sheep are timid animals. I can tell you, every man has been weakened by sin, but the power of God can help us stand, though we and ourselves might be weak. But the grace of God for every man can make us strong. Amen. Amen. One Southern gospel song says, I'm strong in the strength of someone else. And that's where my strength is. It's in him. And I don't want to walk without him holding my hand. Do you? Amen. Amen. Come on, Pat.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whom shall we fear, right? For if God be for us, who can be against us? He said, stand still and watch the salvation of the Lord. I am with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. But I am with you always, even until the end of the age. Hallelujah. Just remain faithful unto him. That's all he says. He who endures till the end shall be saved.
Till the storm passes over, oh, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky, hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Oh, keep me safe, Lord, till the storm passes by. In the darkness of the midnight, have I often hid my face till the storm howls above me? Oh, when there's no hiding place in the crash of the thunder,
precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe, Lord, till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over. Till the thunder sounds more. Till the clouds roll forever from the sky.
Thought she had the word to speak. She sent, actually, Angela sent me, or I forwarded from her phone, but I didn't find the forward, or I would have passed it out. It was a word from the Lord, an elder of her former church where she attended in England, and that word was so timely that I want you to forward it again or something, because I want to get that in the hands of God's people, because that was such a remarkable word that he had spoken in our very timely word. Go ahead.
Thank you. It was basically saying that we, if we're abiding in him, if we're obeying him, if we're loving him, he knows how to protect us as the trials come. He knows how to do it, and he will do it. And he said, look to me to keep my promises because I don't break them, which was wonderful. And then the other thing was that those who have turned their backs on him and those who don't care to know him, they should be afraid because they will be scattered. It was quite something. We'll get it printed out.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Praise the Lord. Angela comes up sometimes during the service, has a word, and I thought, but if you have an offering, I won't stop you. That's for the good of the work of the Lord, absolutely. And I've got a pretty good vestment in Destiny Rescue. It's three of my family members that are very much involved, of which Tom and Sarah are working full-time here in the States for Destiny Rescue. And they are really doing, they're blazing the trail, and God is using them in an awesome way. God's opening door after door. But also Rebecca, who has been, when she comes home on the 18th of March is what her scheduled flight to get into Orlando, she will have spent 22 and a half months there in Thailand serving Destiny Rescue as a volunteer. And God has used her in powerful ways, and she has made a difference, and God has made a real difference in her own life. And I'm sure we will look forward to a testimony from her when she gets back of what God's done and what God's doing in her life, and we appreciate God. So I have some personal vestment in this whole ministry, and we also can say that Tom did his first rescue Sunday right here. He's done several, I don't know how many since, 3 years ago? This is the third year that we've had Tom doing one of these. As a matter of fact, during the shutdown, we did a virtual. How many remembers that? We did a virtual rescue Sunday, and even though there was only Tom and a few of us here, we still was able to rescue a child, and that was awesome. And I appreciate the fact people love God and they love the work of God, and this is a tremendous call. So I want Tom and Sarah to come both and give Sarah a moment to say something. Amen. Sarah has not too long ago got her master's degree with Indiana Wesleyan, so I'm proud of her for that accomplishment. And my daughter Rebecca just finished her bachelor's degree online while she's been there in Thailand, and so we celebrate that, and I'm proud of them for that.
Thanks, Dad. Well, good morning. It's so good to be here. Thanks for coming and joining the Rescue Sunday. And I'll just take a moment. Tom will introduce Destiny Rescue a little bit and just give updates and share and preach. But I just want to share a little bit from my experience the last 2 weeks. Andy, we were at a church last week in, was it Knoxville, Tennessee? They sang the same song. So Tom and I are like, I think we need to hear this song. What do you think? But it is fitting because we've had a little bit of a rough time just in family stuff with Tom and different things going on. And so we've been fighting. You know, normally I feel like you should be on the offensive when it comes to spiritual battle and just praising God and saying, we bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord and just praising in our home. And this week, the last 2 weeks, I feel like I'm on the defensive. Like, I got to catch up here. And so yesterday, Tom and I decided, today is God's day. Normally, you know, that's Sunday, but today is God's day. We're saying we're going back on the offensive. And so we just put music on all day yesterday and just worshiping God and praising him and saying, no, we're not going to be on the defensive. We're going back on the offensive. I don't know where we got off, but there was something there. And because we just felt battle after battle over the last couple weeks. And so as we went to bed last night, just the peace of God rested on us. And I'm just so thankful for that. So I just want to encourage you, if you have a battle in your life, the way to combat that is praise. The way to combat it is praise. I'll say it again. Because as we're praising God and his spirit falls on us, then that peace just settles, doesn't it? It just settles. And I just feel that this morning, just as we said, we're going on back on the offensive this week. But I praise God and I thank him for all he's doing in our life. And, you know, when you feel that attack, you know you're on the right track, right? You know, okay, we are on the front lines rescuing kids that have no one else to rescue them. And God doesn't like that. When we are out there, when you guys are out there yesterday and you're on the offensive, you're saying, no, we want souls to be there next week at City Fest, then God is saying, yes, my peace is there. You're on the offensive. But the enemy doesn't like that. He's going to go on the attack. So I just want to encourage you, as you're praying next week and you're inviting people, like, just be forewarned. When you go on the front lines, you got to praise. You got to keep that relationship going with God and lifting him up, as he will draw all people to himself and he will protect you. As I just, that word from you was just like, yes, that's what I'm hearing this week and last week. So thank you. Thanks, Andy, for that song for the second time in 2 weeks. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. The rescue that almost wasn't. 2 Chronicles 3:1 says, now Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on Moriah, where the Lord had appeared to David floor of Ornan the Jebusite. So in case you didn't hear, Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on Mount Moriah, where the Lord had appeared to his father David at the place that David prepared on the threshing floor at Ornan the Jebusite. The rescue that almost wasn't. Now I got to tell you, there's some pretty exciting things that happen when God decides to rescue, because I've said this over and over. Again, this is the third time that you're going to hear me say it at this church, but the gospel is rescue. The gospel is rescue. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. The gospel is rescue. We didn't deserve it. We couldn't do anything about it. We were guilty. We were caught up and trapped in our sin and our selfishness and all of the things that happened. But the reality is that separated us from God, and God decided to do something about it and stepped in flesh. And as John 1 says, that the Word was made flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have beheld his glory, the glory of the one and only, full of grace and truth. That light shines in the darkness, and darkness doesn't overcome it. God rescues his people. And if you've been rescued, give God a shout of praise this morning. But sometimes you feel like the rescue might not come. Sometimes you see a situation and a circumstance and think, is anything good going to come out of this? Is God going to show up? Is God going to show off? COVID was that year, amen? We're going to be honest. We look at all of the things that have happened over 2020. We think of the loss, the family members, the friends that are no longer with us. And I know that it's hit this church. It's hit everywhere. But there's something that God does in the midst of hardship and loss. God still rescues. In 2020, we were able to rescue 751 individuals. You know what that tells me? It tells me that the people of God were faithful to continue to give, and they were continue to be generous, and they continued to pray. I don't know how many times we got messages from you all that you guys were praying. Every time we saw you, you would say, we're praying for you, we're praying for Destiny Rescue. What's God doing? And you came expecting to hear stories of what God is doing in the midst of all of it. And 751, the last week of 2020, 97 individuals rescued. It's incredible what God is doing through his church. But I want to share with you some updates, but I want to share with you that sometimes in the darkness you think about the topic. I don't want you to get discouraged, because God is doing some amazing things. God is healing and restoring. God is setting free. He is turning and making new, because that's what God does. So if you're here this morning and you're like, I don't know if God can show up in my circumstance or my situation, or can God change this? Can God make it new? That's the business that God is in. So if you would, take a look at this video.
I remember back in 2001 when I launched Destiny Rescue. I was asked by my pastor to take the next Sunday sermon and talk about what I'd seen. And I remember just sitting there in front of the computer trying to work out, what am I going to say to everyone? And I heard a noise inside my head. It was like a dream. And I got up. And I heard the noise from the bedroom, and I went down the hall and opened the door. It was slightly open. And as I opened it, there was a bunch of kids in the room. It was like I was actually doing it, but it was just inside my head, and they just looked desperate. All I could think of, oh, they must be hungry. So I raced to the kitchen and got them some food, and went into the room and gave the kids some food. And as I handed them the food, I heard some more noise, and I put my head out the door and went to the next bedroom. And there was just another bunch of kids, and it's like, us truth, these guys must be hungry as well. So I raced into the kitchen, and each time I did that, my house just got a longer and longer hallway. It's like this never-ending hallway of door after door. And I was in this panic of running around trying to find food, and I've got no food in the fridge. And I went outside, and as I went outside, there was more kids outside in the backyard. I could hear this noise behind the fence. I to the fence, and I pulled myself up over and looked over the fence, and all I could see was this sea of kids. And I just remember feeling that heaviness of, this is so huge, like, how can I do anything that would could change all this? It's just too big for me. And I remember sort of sliding down the fence, just feeling totally defeated. And as I turned around and sort of just dropped myself on the grass, I looked up and then I started to see some faces that I knew, and they were feeding the kids or consoling them or playing games with the kids. So I got up and started to walk inside, and as I went inside, a call center, and people were on the phone telling other people about the need and that we had to do something. And I saw people trying to inspire people to get involved and, you know, help us rescue another kid. And I went from this place of just total desperation of, this problem is so huge, what can one person ever do, to turning around and feeling that peace of, I don't have to do it alone, that people are going to hear about this, people are going to get involved, people will be inspired, and as a team or an army of people, that we can have an impact, that we can end this.
Rescue doesn't happen without you. Rescue doesn't happen without the church, the people of God, giving generously, praying continuously, saying that we are in this together, linking arms and saying we have to do something about this. It's the rescue that almost didn't happen. Because if it wasn't for the church joining and being a part, we'd only be able to do a little bit. But you're able to help us magnify the work. And it can I just give you some statistics? So in 3 years ago, I had my first rescue Sunday here. And you guys as a church rescued one individual, gave enough, $1,500 to rescue a child. The next year, you guys gave and rescued a child. And I have faith to believe. In fact, Sister Sarah showed me the numbers just from that first part. You guys are almost there. I believe that today another child is going to be rescued. But because of your faith, church, you inspired the Church of God Mountain Assembly to jump on board and to rescue. Over $11,000 in 3 years, almost 8 kids rescued. By the time we end our time today, there will be 8 individuals rescued because of the faith of a people who have come together on mission. We got to, well, come on. Amen. We got to celebrate that, amen? And you guys led the way. Living Waters, you led the way for that to happen. And you inspired and you gave and you prayed. It's the rescue that happened. Because of you, a young lady like Amaya could be rescued. Amaya was 14 when our agents found her. Now, what tends to happen in this reality is that kids are vulnerable. Realities happen and affect the family, and the kids need to go into a community to find a job. And Amaya went in to go find a job. And as she went in to find a job, she was lied to and tricked and trapped to working at an establishment that she thought was a restaurant. And she was working in a brothel, not knowing exactly what to expect, but now forced to serve as customers. She was 14 when our agents found her, and our agents rescue covertly. They go undercover to places where kids are being trafficked, but they also do raids. So if you're watching online and you've never heard about Destiny Rescue, or you're here this morning and you've never heard, we rescue kids out of sexual exploitation and human trafficking. Our agents are undercover in these places, but we also do raids where we gather intelligence. We work with police departments to bring raids, to rescue as many as we can and to arrest the trafficker and bring justice. And that's what happened in Amaya's case. Our agents gathered the intelligence. They worked with law enforcement. They did a raid. There's only one problem. Amaya wasn't there. But we rescued a lot of kids that day. We celebrate that. But our agents knew that Amaya was still missing and they didn't know where she was. So they began to look and it took almost 2 years to find Amaya again. And they found her and they began to talk to her and they began to tell her about what we do and building trust. And Amaya at this point had been lied to so many times by so many people promising all these things. She thought that we were just another one in the crowd that was going to lie to her for exploitation. Then COVID hit, and it shut everything down. And Amaya, living on the street, having been forced to do drugs and different things in a place of vulnerability, called one of our agents and said, "I need help." And our team jumped into action, and we were able to rescue Amaya. She's in our aftercare program, and she's growing, and she's seeing God do amazing things. But it's the rescue that almost didn't happen. But you've got to be ready when God shows up to spring into action, and God may use different realities and circumstances. God can use pandemics and plagues. God can use hardship and famine. God can use all of these things, but the people of God need to be humble enough to step into the position when it presents itself and to say, "God, we need you to do something." Now, can I tell you the story of Nuon? Nuon was 15 and when she got a job at a karaoke TV bar, thinking that she was going to work at a restaurant. She's 15, she lost her dad, raised by her mom and her brother, and she had to go to town to find work. Now, when she did, She was discouraged by all the realities that happened, because not only did she have those vulnerabilities, she didn't really speak the language of the country that she was in, which is not uncommon. And when our team rescued her, she comes into our aftercare and she's pursuing salon training. She wants to open up a salon. And as she's going through the training, she's finding it very difficult and she's struggling with learning language and she gets frustrated and she believes the lies of other people who are influencing her. So she quits and she walks out the door. She goes back to the line of work that she was at before because she felt like that was the only thing she was worthy of. Our team goes back into establishments to find kids, and one of our agents realized and recognized her and said, "Wait a second, we had a conversation a while back and you came out. What happened?" And she explains what went down, and he says, "Honey, you are worth rescue." And she leaves with him. And our team came around her and began to encourage her, no matter how dark the situation, how difficult the challenge is, "You've got this. You can do it. God loves you and God cares for you." And Nuon presses in and persists even in the midst of challenges. She humbles herself and says, I may not know it all, but I'm going to continue to press in." Nuon just recently said, "I want to open a salon so that I can help other girls like me." She's getting ready to graduate. She's going to do just that. I can keep on telling tons and tons of stories like this, but you get the point. Rescue almost didn't happen for them, but because somebody leaned in, say lean in. Somebody leaned in spite of the perception, in spite of challenges, in spite of hardship, they leaned in and rescue happened. So I need you today, as the people of God, the people in this room, the people watching online, I need you to lean in. Because there's rescue coming for kids around the world trapped in sexual exploitation and trafficking. There's almost a million of them, by the way. Trafficking is the fastest growing illegal enterprise in the world. It's a $150 billion industry. Sex trafficking alone generates $11 million an hour. It will outpace the sale of guns and drugs. It's in every country, it's in every state in the United States, it is in our backyards. And we need to be aware of it because God wants to bring rescue through us if we will humble ourselves and lean in. But I also believe this to be true. There are people in this room this morning, and there are people watching online that you need God to rescue you. And my challenge to you is lean in and humble yourself. Because 2 Chronicles 3 tells the story of Solomon building the temple on the what we refer to as the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. It's Mount Moriah. Now, if you know your Old Testament history, Mount Moriah should mean something. This is the place where Abraham tried to offer his son Isaac. Mount Moriah is the place where Abraham says to Isaac, "We're going to the mountain to worship and sacrifice." And Isaac says, "Dad, where's the sacrifice?" And he says, "God will provide the sacrifice." And they get up on the mountain, and he's humbling himself and becoming obedient to do the thing that he felt like God was telling him to do. And the angel of the Lord stops him, and he doesn't sacrifice his son. There's a ram caught in the thicket, and he sacrifices the ram. And him and his son know that God is the one who ordains the steps of mankind, that God is the one who leads, God is the one who is in charge, and they are to humble themselves and follow the direction of God. That's Mount Moriah. If that was enough, that's totally worth building a temple to the Lord of heaven and earth. That's a special place for Israel. But that's not the place that the chronicler, the historian, writes and says that they're building the temple there. He says another story. He says that this is where David bought the threshing floor from a Jebusite. If I was writing the Bible, I would have led with Abraham. You know why? It's a better story. Like, Abraham shows up, God is there and speaks, and the ram caught in the thicket. I wouldn't pick David. But you know why I wouldn't pick David? Because my theme song, Brother Andy, would be me. I thought I could do a lot on my own. Thought of myself as a mighty big man. The story of David is where David actually has to admit that I can't even walk without you holding my hand. That's the story of David. The story of David is not this great king who beats a giant as a little boy. That's the David we want to prop up and remember. That's only a small fraction of David's story. David's story is better known by what he did with Bathsheba and murdering Uriah. David is better known by 2 Samuel chapter 24. And if you have your Bibles, that's where we're going to be. David's story is more composed of what happens in 2 Samuel and what happens with David and Bathsheba, what happens with Uriah. A fraction of his story is Goliath. 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 18. Actually, let me just pause and back up a second. Let me tell you what's happening in 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel is David looking at his people, and he's looking at his armies, and he's like, I've amassed a pretty big army. I have lots of people who can fight with me. I'm going to be victorious no matter what comes my way. I can take it because I have all the people around me. I can have it handled. I've got pride. I am prideful. I have all of this stuff, all of these people. So he sends Joab, his kind of next in command, to go count the army. Like, you need to count things. Counting matters, but it's the heart of the matter that we're focused on. Because Joab realizes, he's like, wait a second. King, I just wish that God would give you 100 times what you have, and let's just call it that, and let's move on. Because see, sometimes when we have a moment where we're not willing to lean in, God sends us somebody to graciously encourage us to press in. God sends us somebody to love us and care for us and challenge us to take a step in and to not go that direction. But David bypasses him, which is another historical David move. He bypasses everybody, all of his advisors, constantly. So what he does is Joab comes to him and says, King, I don't want you to do this. And the king says, go and make a count. So he does. And the prophet Gad comes to him. He begins to challenge him. And verse 10 says this. It says that, and David's heart condemned him after he had numbered the people. So David said to the Lord, I have greatly sinned in what I have done. But now I pray, O Lord, take away the iniquity of your servant, for I have done very foolishly. So he began to recognize, because isn't God good enough to challenge us by his Holy Spirit to convict us? It's kindness that leads us to repentance, the text says in Romans. God's goodness and his grace, his love and mercy challenges us to lean in. So God's Spirit was dealing with David, and David says, I've sinned greatly. Prophet Gad comes to him and says, here's the reality. Because of your pride, one of three things has to happen. He says, you can have 7 years of famine. I don't like that choice. You can have 3 days of, or you can have 3 months of fleeing from your enemies. Or you can have 3 days of plague. And he says in verse 14, I will fall into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great. So he understands and knows where the goodness of God is. So he leans into this moment. And because of that, a famine comes and 70,000 people die. That's a high cost for the actions of leaders. Now think about that for a second. I need us to understand today that our actions have consequences, good or bad. Our actions have consequences, good or bad. You can choose today to lean in, and lean as you lean in, God could totally redeem a circumstance or a situation. Amen? Or we can harden ourselves and harden our hearts, and we can draw away, and we begin to see what God does on the other side. Kind of what our dear sister said this morning, the word at the front. That reality happens, and we know it all too well. Because of that, I know I'm preaching to the choir, but I need to establish this reality here. And the reality is that we know the impact of our actions. And your actions today, through your generosity, through your prayers, are going to have a tremendous impact. Verse 17 says, then David spoke to the Lord when he saw the angel who was striking the people and said, surely I have sinned, I have done wickedly, but these sheep have... what have they done? Let your hand, I pray, be against me and against my father's house. He begins to lean in even more. And here's verse 18. And Gad came that day to David and said to him, go up and erect an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Arunah, the Jebusite. So David, according to the word of the Lord, went up as the Lord commanded. Now Arunah looked, and he saw the king and his servants coming toward him. So Arunah went out and bowed before the king with his face to the ground. And he said, why has my lord the king come to his servant? Then David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be withdrawn from the people. Now Arunah said to David, let my lord the king take the offer up wherever seems good to him. Look, here are the oxen for the burnt sacrifice, the threshing implements and the yokes for the oxen for wood. All of these, O king, Arunah has given to the king. Now, That's just a good offer, right? Like if you're coming to build an altar to the Lord and you show up and the guy who owns it says, I'm just going to give it to you. And I'm going to give you the animals for the sacrifice, and I'm going to give you all the yokes for the oxen to use as wood. Anybody else want to take that offer? Like it's great. Like you've just given me everything I need to do this. But David, instead of arrogantly saying, yeah, I will take it, he says this. He leans in and he says, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price. Nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God, which has cost me nothing. Think about that for a second. David leaning in. When David has, at this point, said, I can have anything done that I want to have done. I am at the pinnacle of my leadership. I am at the pinnacle of power and authority. He humbles himself and says, I will not offer anything that doesn't cost me something. I will lean in. Can I encourage you, church? Now, we've been walking in relationship for more than 3 years. Sarah and I have been married for 18? Almost 18. sorry, I was doing a, the reason why I pause is I was doing a podcast about a month ago with an organization, and they asked how long we've been married, and I said 14. So I got it wrong. I'm confessing, because we're family, that I got it wrong. So I'm looking for 17. And Dad, you've made the same mistake recently. I'm in good company. And you've been here for how long? 14 years. Right at. So there are many of you, even in conversation this morning, some of you are like, man, I remember the first time I met you and Sarah years ago. We have walked together and we have done life together. We have broken bread together. We have shed tears together. We have prayed together. I know your heart. And you as a church do not offer things that haven't cost you. You are sacrificial in your prayer, in your giving, in your encouragement, in your engagement. You go out of the way to make Sarah and I feel welcome every time we walk in the door. And you, church, are incredible. So when you hear me talking about David doing this, it's not me trying to tell you that you're not doing that. You are. Take encouragement from it this morning. You're already ahead of David. You're already there. You get the fact that you can't offer a sacrifice that doesn't cost you anything. It's not a sacrifice at that point. And for David, David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. Now that's about $500. And as I was reading this passage, I looked at Sarah and I'm like, man, like David had all of this gold and he had all of this stuff and it only cost him $500? Like that's encouraging to me, because it's not about the amount of money that you spend on a gift or an offering. It only matters the heart in which you offer it. It's Jesus and the widow with two mites. It doesn't matter the amount that she threw in. What mattered was the heart of which she gave it. And she wanted it to be used of the Lord. And she trusted that the Lord would use it. So she gave it and did with it as she should. And David here, then I read Chronicles. As I read Chronicles, it expounds on the story a little bit. And in Chronicles, it says that he actually bought the entire mountain for about $300,000. So not only did he buy the mountain, but he bought the threshing floor too. Which tells me that when we go to give an offering to the Lord, we go all the way. We don't just buy the mountain. We buy the stuff necessary to give the sacrifice. So this morning, if you find yourself holding back from the Lord, I want to encourage you in your obedience. Go all the way. It's worth it. Go all the way. Many of you are nodding your head because you know it to be true. You've seen God's faithfulness. It says, and David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord heeded the prayers for the land, and the plague was withdrawn from Israel. The rescue that almost didn't happen happened because David leaned in. And David went all the way. And David did what was necessary. And you're doing that today, church. You're leaning in and you're doing what's necessary and you're continuing. Can I tell you that the reason why people are going to step into cross the line of faith next weekend at City Fest is because you went all the way. You went to fairgrounds and you went to restaurants and you went to gas stations and you began to make invites and you've been praying and you've been investing, and God is using you because you are a church that is marked by going all the way. You don't hold back. You can be said of, like Paul says to the church, where he commends them for their generous giving and how they lead the way. You are a church that leads the way. You led it the way with the denomination, with Church of God Mountain Assembly, and there are kids being rescued all over because of churches. I'm getting ready to go on a speaking tour of Church of God Mountain Assembly churches in 3 weeks. 8 churches in 7 days. You can pray for me. But it's because there were people who had vision to say, I want to see kids rescued from exploitation and trafficking. And you stepped up and you began to pray, and people began to take notice and said, I want to be a part of that. I want to link arms and be a part of what God is doing. But can I tell you that the reality for David was a different reality for King Saul. Old Testament tells us that King Saul was a guy who, instead of humbling himself and leaning in when the sacrifice came, he actually offered his sacrifice from a place of fear, a place of pride. 1 Samuel chapter 13, 11 and 12, Samuel says, "What have you done?" Saul says, "When I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that you did not come within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered together at Michmash, then I said, 'The Philistines will now come down on me at Gilgal.' And I have not made supplication to the Lord. Therefore, I felt compelled and offered a burnt offering." Sometimes we make offerings from places of fear, places of pride, of arrogance. We make offerings from the wrong place. And if I can preach a little bit, can I do that? If I can preach a little bit, the challenge for us is when we come to a time of worship, when we come to a time of giving, of stepping out and obeying the Lord, the challenge is, how's our heart? How's our heart this morning? How's your heart? How's mine? Because what Saul offered is Saul, the sin of Saul was not sacrifice. The sin of Saul was the fear that drove the sacrifice. Well, I need people's approval. So if people are going to stay with me and do the things that I need them to do, then I need to offer sacrifice. I'm going through the motions to do the thing that everybody expects so that everybody around me is happy, so that everybody likes me, or so that everybody will follow me or do the things that I need them to do. That's what Saul was doing. It wasn't a sin of sacrifice. It was a sin of fear, of pride, and allowing it to dictate and determine his actions. See, the word compelled there is the same word that's used when it says David was convicted. We can be compelled or challenged or motivated by the wrong things when it comes to doing the right things. And we have to pause and say, God, where's my heart? How's my heart in this? I think David got it right simply because he wasn't David. I don't think that it's something that's new that was just because of David. I think David learned a principle that is applicable to all of us. That principle is this. It's found in Psalm 51. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite or humble heart. These, O God, you will not despise. What if the Lord wants to use you in your neighborhood to impact your neighbors? But you have neighbors like me. I'm loud. Anybody have loud neighbors? Anybody have neighbors who don't mow the yard? Anybody have neighbors who maybe listen to the TV a little bit too much, or at a volume, or their music, or they're doing all of these things that you're just like, that's just frustrating. So when you're frustrated at somebody, you don't share the gospel with them. You want to avoid them. So what if the sacrifices of God are a humble heart and a broken heart, where you realize that I should love somebody in spite of what they do, or in spite of who they are, or what their situation or circumstance is, so you lean in and you're able to love your neighbor as yourself, and through that they go, wait a second, you're different. Why are you like this? And you're able to give them hope. I mean, Scripture says to be able to give an answer for the hope that you have. Amen? And if that's what Scripture teaches, then we lean in on those moments, because I will tell you, the rescue that almost didn't happen, if David hadn't have leaned in, because the chronicle doesn't mention Abraham. He goes back to David and says, this is the place where David offered sacrifice. The rescue that almost didn't happen, you have to fast forward 12 generations. Because you know who walks on to the Temple Mount 12 generations from David? Jesus. Now, it's not Solomon's temple then, it's Herod's temple. Solomon's temple had been torn down and Herod's temple now built. But now think about this. If David realizes that the sacrifices of God are a broken and contrite heart that God won't despise, when David writes Psalm 51, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation." When David writes that in Psalm 51 from Uriah and Bathsheba, he now understands what God is asking of him and where God will meet him if he steps into the fact that he sinned again. He's not worried about the fact that he sinned again. He knows that God will forgive him. We can have confidence that we are forgiven and that we are made right with God when we confess our sins. Because 1 John says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. David knows the character of God. But what happens, and the rescue that almost didn't happen, was if David hadn't have leaned in, Solomon wouldn't have seen what his dad was doing. And when Solomon saw what his dad was doing, he began to realize that there's something bigger. Because see, I want to do a little teaching here for a second. If you break up the Old Testament is known by the Mosaic Law. But before they talk about the Mosaic Law, they talk about the Abraham Covenant. You know the Abraham Covenant? The Abraham Covenant is that through you, all people, the entire world will be blessed through your line. So God promises through Abraham, Jesus is coming. And that all the world will be blessed. That's amazing. Like, that's why if I was writing history in Chronicles, I would go back to Abraham and say, this is where Abraham, because this is what started the promise that Jesus was coming into the world. This place, this moment of obedience marked and set that into fruition. But then you fast forward a little bit and you got David. Buys the threshing floor on Mount Moriah. And he offers a sacrifice and the plague stops. And Solomon sees that his dad, with a humble and contrite heart, doesn't offer a sacrifice that doesn't cost him anything. He leans in no matter how hard it was, no matter how uncomfortable it might have been for David. And you also have the David covenant. The Davidic covenant is this, that through you, you will always have a king who sits on the throne. So Solomon has it reinforced again. He was reinforced. He saw the Abraham covenant that says that through you, all people will be blessed. It's reinforced by his dad, who he says, when God says you will always have a king on the throne. When Solomon steps up to Mount Moriah to build a temple, he's like, it's a no-brainer. And we know when we look back at history, Jesus stepped foot on the very mountain that David was at with a humble and contrite heart. The very mountain that Abraham stood to offer his son Isaac, which tells me the moment we have a sacrifice to give, that Jesus himself steps on it and takes over and says, I'll bring rescue through your sacrifice. He'll bring rescue to you. He'll bring rescue to your neighbor. And church, he's bringing rescue to kids around the world. That's the rescue that happens. That's the rescue that happens through humility and leaning in. So let me ask you, church. Are you leaning in? Is there an area of your life where God is challenging you to be humble and lean? Because my theme song says, where I learned to stand is not here. Where I learned to stand is here. Scripture says that Jesus, being found equal with God, didn't consider it something to be grasped, but he lowered himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's what Paul tells the church you should be like. Be like Jesus. Imitate that humility. And Jesus has all of the Old Testament, all of this history to show God is faithful. James says that God draws near to the humble. He gives grace to the humble, but he opposes the proud. If you would stand with me this morning. When you have the right heart, church, you never know the impact that you're going to have. It could be your neighbor. It could be somebody in this room. Maybe this morning, as Pastor had his hand, had people raise their hands to say, I have a need, I have a health need. Maybe the Lord put it on your heart to go pray for somebody and you just stopped for whatever reason. God moves as a result of humility and obedience, church. You never know the rescue that could come until you're willing to step out and meet him in the moment. You have to lean in. So I want to invite you this morning to maybe just say to the Lord, Lord, I am all in. I'm going to lean in. Maybe there's something that you felt prompted to do this morning. Pray for somebody, encourage someone. Feel the freedom by the Spirit of God to do that now. But these altars are going to open and people will come and pray with you if you come up and pray. But I want to just invite you to follow the prompting of the Lord. Whatever he may put on your heart to do, lean in. Lean in, church, because rescue comes because the church of God, the people of God, lean in. God is faithful. He was faithful with Abraham. He was faithful with David. He will be faithful with us. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's minister one to another. Or in the altar, can we come and ask God to help us that we might be an instrument whereby God would use us? He is Lord. Is he Lord of your life? He is the Lord. If anybody needs prayer for anything, come. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, oh, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Yes, he is Lord. He is Lord. Every minister that's available, could you come forth? And if anybody needs prayer, come on and let them pray with you. Minister, health, spiritual, whatever your need might be, that will come and minister to you today. For every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess. This is a great time to come and get someone to agree with you in prayer. Whatever the need might be in your life, the Lord will do this work. Hallelujah. Pray one for another. Hallelujah. Yes, he is Lord. He is Lord. And he has risen from the dead. And he is Lord. Every knee shall bow. Let's take some time to pray. Let the Holy Spirit work. Let God's Spirit of God, let the Spirit of God minister. There's needs among us. God wants to minister right now. He wants to do his work. Lord, we love you. We set our heart upon you. Help us to, Lord, give ourselves to you, Lord. Lord, because we believe you, because we have a broken and contrite spirit, because we're humble before you, Lord, we want to honor you, God, in our worship, not out of fear, but God, out of faith, out of our devotion to you, Lord, knowing that you are God and you are almighty. There's nothing, Lord, that you cannot do. Nothing, nothing, Lord. Oh, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess,
than Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. And He has risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Yes, He is Lord. He is Lord. And He has risen from the dead, and He is Lord, and every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Yes, He's my Lord. He's my Lord. And He has risen from the dead, and He's my Lord. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. My Lord, He's my Lord. Here, my Lord, and He has risen from the dead, and He's my Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I love You, Lord. I lift my voice to worship You, O my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what You let it be a sweet, sweet sound in Your ear. I love You, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship. joy, my King, in what you hear, and let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
One more time. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh, my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King. You hear, let it be a sweet,
sweet sound in your ear.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Sing it, Andy.
Oh,
yes, Jesus. Loves me,
yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Sing it again.
Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Amen. We got a preliminary figure. I know there's more coming. That's awesome. That's awesome. Woo! And there's more coming, because I know there is. So that's exciting. Hallelujah. Another young, if you can picture in your mind, another young lady who feels no hope, but yet finds hope. Yay. Give the Lord another praise. Thank you, Jesus. Be sure and stop by this table back there. They've got set up, got some pictures there, and Sarah and Tom will probably be back there to answer any questions you might have. And just be sure to thank them for taking time in their schedule to be able to come to be with us, and we thank you. Father, we dismiss this service, looking forward to tonight's service, praying, God, that you will just be with us, keep us all safe, bless us, keep us, cause your face to shine upon us. And may there be peace and favor. And we ask it, we pray for it in Jesus' name. Amen.